Just a brief background. What's before this presentation is that I actually took part in the internal company hackathon at SP Digital with my colleague Soup. So we built an app, a Slack client to be precise, on a very old platform. So as you know, it's Windows 3.1, which it became quite popular on Hacker News. It was number one on Hacker News for a few hours. Yeah, in the end, it got like, I think 700 plus points. So yeah, I think quite a lot of you found it interesting. I thought it was quite a boring thing, but no. Okay, so what is Windows 3.1, right? So I'm pretty sure Windows 3.1 is older than many of you here. So it is actually a series of 16-bit operating systems from Microsoft, first released in 1992. But the version that I'm going to show today is a variant called Windows for Workgroups. It was released in 1993. So what's so special about this OS? Because this is the first one by Microsoft to have network abilities. I mean, let us think for a moment. This is the first Windows OS to have network abilities, right? Official network abilities. Like, I mean, before that, people hacked things, but this is the official one. Okay, so I know I asked some of you to sign up, right? Retro Slack, but not many of you did. But never mind. Those who sign up, just go to the Win31 channel. Let me switch over to my very ancient laptop. Okay. Wow, a lot of y'all never seen it before, right? Okay, let me sit down here. Okay. So as you can see, right, this is a Windows 3.1 PC. You can take a look here. I'm not faking things. This is not a VM, obviously. This is a real PC. Okay, so let's go to the Win31 channel. Those whoever have already signed up for the Retro Slack workspace, I think only a handful did, something about 7 or 8 of you. So I know Michael did at least. So Michael, can you please post some messages there to prove that this client works? Win31. Yeah. Just send something there. And try to keep the message short and no pictures. Can emojis work? Okay, so you see, Michael just sent a message, so yeah, so now let me reply, just say, hi Mike, okay, from Win3.1, okay, so I'll just click send, okay, so I think Michael should get that. Yep. Yeah, you got that right. I don't know, who else is actually on this retro Slack? Not, who else? Actually not much, right? Actually, I post this just now, 1 hour nobody use. Okay, and then Michael said to send some more stuff. Send emoji. Okay, send.
Wow.
Okay. This person called Jasmine sent something. Yes. Okay. So yes, I got some evidence that this app works. Okay. Yeah. So let me go back. Okay. Okay, so some of the top questions I got from people is, how does one develop an app like that, right? Okay, so this is a very complicated diagram. Let me go into detail first. I actually developed the app on my modern Mac, okay? So this one here. And it's running a Windows 2000 VM, okay? Inside is running a compiler called Visual C++ 1.52. That was a version of Visual C++ released in 1993. Then there's a Samba shared folder, so files can be communicated between them. Then the binary, right, is actually transported over the network to my actual Windows 3.1 PC. So occasionally it can be tested that way. So let me go into detail. Okay, so why this version of Visual C++, right? It is the last compiler for Windows 3.1. Okay, so it's a 16-bit compiler. The significance of that is that a 16-bit program can only be officially run on up to a 32-bit version of Windows. You cannot run it on a 64-bit Windows, right? Although theoretically there is a Windows 10 32-bit, but I don't have that, so I use Windows 2000. So why Windows 2000, right? Because Windows 2000 is the oldest OS that is supported by VirtualBox with full drivers. That means you can copy paste stuff inside, you can do network share, right? It's oldest, you can go back already. Then the Windows 2000 can also communicate with both Mac, Windows 10 and Windows 3.1. Over Samba share. Windows 3.1 cannot share files with Windows 10 and Mac because the version of Samba it uses is so old that the modern PCs, modern OS cannot communicate with it. Right? But Windows 2000 is a very good bridge between both of them. Okay, so now how do I connect this old PC to the internet, right? So this PC does not have Wi-Fi. I mean, yeah. Okay, so it doesn't even have Ethernet, okay? So I use a paraport network adapter. I mean, y'all may not have seen this. What is this thing, right? This is the days before USB, okay? And this is normally used by printer, but it can also be used as a paraport, as a network adapter, if you got this one, okay? So let's talk about coding stuff, right? In the modern times today, whenever we want to look for resources, the first thing we do is Google, or we go to Stack Overflow, right? Or we go to API documentation, right? Or we also can use online code simulators. However, what happens, right, if you don't have any of this, right? And this was a situation I faced. I don't have any of this when it comes to coding Windows 3.1, because Windows 3.1 is older than Google and Stack Overflow. Okay? So I did things the old-fashioned way. I used a book. This one, this book is for real. I actually bought this book, yeah. So this book was published in 1992. And someone commented, right, if you're going to program for Windows 3.1, buy this book. You pay for itself in a matter of hours. And I agree with that. So let me pass around this book. And it has some sample code, and it's given in a good old floppy drive. Probably this. So flip around. Yeah, that safe icon is real. It's not 3D printed. Okay. Okay, so the language that I use is C. You may think that, okay, C language is still used today, in fact, although not very much. But it is an old version of C. Okay, so it uses a version of C called C89. Okay, so C has undergone many revisions since then, like C99, C11, C18. But the compiler was released in 1993. And obviously, the compiler can only support a language that's older than itself. Right? So the language older than itself is C89. Okay? So let me go through some of the weird stuff this old version of C has. So the first thing, right, is that you cannot declare new variables in the middle of a scope. Okay, so what this means is that, let's say if you have a function, the variables that you want to use in the function have to be all declared at the top. You cannot have a variable declaration that's in the middle. So that's why you see this, for example, this top of the function, why got so many things here? Because this is all the functions that I use, all the variables that I use, right? Okay, so there may be pros and cons. You shouldn't see this as a disadvantage, because some people say that it may actually increase code readability, because it forces you to put all the variables at the top. Whoever uses this function, reads this function, will know what all the variables are being used in the function. Okay, the next one is unsafe functions. Okay, so there's one particular function called sprintf. So you all may heard of printf. So sprintf basically is a printf but printing to an array. Okay, so for in modern times, right, we are highly encouraged to use smprintf. So smprintf means that you can specify the number of bytes you want to write to a buffer. If you do not, right, there's a risk of buffer overflow. Because if, let's say, the formatted string is greater than the size of the buffer, sprintf will overwrite and continue to write on. So you have problems. The problem is smprintf came out in C99. So I'm forced to use smprintf, the older function, and have to be careful not to cause a buffer overflow. Then another one is 16-bit computing, right? So let me first quote this on Wikipedia. In the context of an IBM PC compatible and a Wintel platforms, a 16-bit application is any software written for MS-DOS, OS2, or early versions of Microsoft Windows, such as Windows 3.1, which originally ran on 16-bit Intel 88 or 286. So programs containing more than 2 to the power of 16, 64K of instructions and data therefore require special instructions to switch between the 64 kilobyte segments, increasing the complexity of programming 16-bit applications. Right, so the key part is here. As if things are not hard enough, Wikipedia still need to purposely say it's very difficult. Okay, so why? So let me go in a bit of detail. In modern times, right, this is the amount of memory that we have for our app. A default stack size for a modern program is 8 megabytes. Right? You can increase that, but this is the default. The heap size is how much memory you can address, which on 32-bit platform is about 4 gigabytes. For a 64-bit platform, right, I don't want to put a number there. It's very, very huge. Okay, so pointer size, 32-bit and 64-bit, respectively. So what about 16-bit platform, right? The stack size of a 16-bit app is only 4 kilobytes. It's 1,000 times, like 3 orders of magnitude less. the heap is divided into two. It's something called local heap up to 64 kilobytes and something called global heap. 64 kilobyte segments up to 60 megabytes. This means that you have to address memory in 64 kilobyte segments, and your total amount of memory that your single process can use is 16 megabytes only. 16 megabytes. Nowadays, our app use how much? We don't know, right? We don't care. And the pointers, right? Nowadays, we think of it as 32-bit or 64-bit pointers. There's something called near and far pointer. Still got this kind of thing, right? Okay, so the difference is that for near pointer, right, is your default size. Because 16-bit platform means 16-bit pointer, when you do a malloc to allocate memory, you get a 16-bit pointer. This part is obvious. The thing is, at that time, people didn't realize that even 64 kilobytes is very little, right? So they want to use more memory. The problem is the pointer size is only 16-bit, right? So to address more memory than that, right, they use something called a far. So you have to address memory very far from you. So they have something called a 16-bit selector. And I shall not go into detail, but this is what it does, what it means. If you Google about it, right, you will find out that Windows 3.1's far pointer is based on something called a 286 protected mode model. Okay, so what this means is that the 16-bit selector is mapped to a 24-bit address. Okay, so 2 to the power of 24, you get this 16 megabyte limit. Okay, yeah. So very difficult to access. So how do you allocate memory from this? Because obviously 64 kilobyte is not enough for my app. I need to allocate memory far away, right? So the answer, right, actually it cannot be Googled. It has to be located in the book. Okay, so I'll briefly explain what's all this thing, right? To normally allocate something, it's just malloc. Then when you're done, you're free, right? But to allocate something from a global heap, right, it's very complicated. You need to specify the size, call this bunch of functions. Then after that, right, you need to make sure that how much memory you are being allocated. I mean, you ask this amount doesn't mean you get this amount. Okay? Then after you're done, remember to free the memory. Right? So without the book, I wouldn't have known how to do it. Okay, so network stuff, right? Okay, so making a network request is very, I would say, complicated. Nowadays, for example, if you use GoLang, you just do a post or something, right? You just use a HTTP package. Just one line, right? You can do already. This one, cannot do one line. So, let's look at the top, right? You probably recognize what is this. This is a post request structure, right? So modern languages, seldom people construct a post request by hand like that. You call the functions and populate with your headers and all the required stuff. This one, I need to manually define. Okay, after that, define the socket with TCP, set the IP address, set all the stuff. Okay, send the message, then all this, you get a reply, then close the socket. Now everything is done for you automatically. But this wasn't the case. This post request, this WinSock thing, it still exists today. So every programming language below, under the hood, they probably still do something like that, but it's all abstracted away from you. Another thing is no HTTPS. So this was a very huge challenge for me. So I decided to cheat. I put a proxy in between. So this proxy, right, is not something that was off the shelf. I actually had to write a Go program to do it. So what this Go program does, right, is that it will actually receive the HTTP request from the Windows 3.1 app, then you forward it as HTTPS to the Slack server. Then whatever reply that comes back, right, it will just be relayed back to the app. Right? It's just a transparent middleman, no manipulation at all. Okay. So why? Because I look at all the libraries, right, it's very hard to do. I mean, modern days you use OpenSSL, even do something like that. But who compiles OpenSSL for a 16-bit platform? I don't think it's possible. Well, maybe it's not impossible, but it probably take many years to do it. Okay, so I added this line in because people complain, say I cheat or what. So I say, priorists may not like this solution, but this is the best I can do with my abilities in a reasonable amount of time. I don't spend so much time on this app to do the HTTPS stuff, right? That's not the point. Then another one is JSON. After you get the data, you still have to pass the JSON, right? So this is a typical way on GoLang, a very simplified way. So this is an example JSON string that I will get from Slack. Okay. So how do you normally process it? It's like a key value pair thing, right? You submit the pass the key, you get the value out. Then this example here is that you're just iterating through the key value pairs. Very simple if the API is there. But do you believe JSON API exists on Windows 3.1? Right, no, right? Okay, so I managed to locate a JSON library that is compatible with C89. Oh, lucky, this is the one and only one I could find. Yeah, so the trouble doesn't end there, lah. Because this guy, right, when he wrote this C89 library, he recognizes the fact that if you have to use his library, your system probably does not have enough memory. Right, so the way that his library functions is not like that. You see, let's think of what happens behind the scenes here. You call a marshal, right? Basically, what's happening is that the API is constructing a dictionary, right? And then you can do the key value mapping. So the size of this dictionary is definitely as large as the original JSON string. Definitely, in fact, it's more, all right, to hold the dictionary. So doing this will mean easily more than double the memory usage. So this guy recognizes that you cannot double your memory usage just like that. So what he does is that when you call his API, you pass a JSON string, you will get an array of tokens, okay? And each token, he will provide the start and end position of the parse key or value. So let me demonstrate this example here. So this is the JSON string that one will get from Slack. So the tokens, right, up to you to define how many tokens that you want to pass out. Then you call his API. So in this example, I'm iterating through. So when I get the first token, right, I have a start, and then I have an end position, right? So with the start and the end position, I get the token size. So what this token returns, right, the start position is basically the index of the array where the key or value starts. Example, right, this, okay, my mouse cannot show. Okay, so the value for this okay, right, is actually 0, 1, 2. Start is 2, end is 3. So you can, so and so on. So that's why it's a bit of trouble to use this, because you have to manually extract the key or value out, based on the start and end position. Then you copy to another array. So it's not that straightforward, right? So who JSON parsing like this is like, wow, difficult. And that is not all, because it's limited to the total size of the array. For example, max tokens here, right, I limit to 128. So 128 means that this library will only look for the first 128 keys or values, which is actually not enough. Because, for example, the number of JSON, the number of messages that you have in the Slack channel is so great, right? You definitely 128, you can't cover all. So I need another level of optimization. Because if I put a high value like 1000, my stack usage will be so high. And remember that Windows 3.1 stack is only 4 kilobytes. Show a bus a stack size one. So I need another one more level of optimization, which is, okay, so this is an example of what I'll receive from Slack. So this is the messages, and this is the user ID. So first, right, I will actually look for the keyword text, right? So by using a C function called str, is to look for a substring. If I locate it, right, then I'll ask the library to process the next 4. No need to process 128. Just from here onwards, process these 4, right? And after that, extract these 2 out. Then copy to another data structure. Then I repeat the process again. So and continue. So this worked for me, lah. So I don't have to use such a lot of memory for it. Then what about test-driven development, right? I mean, nowadays, this is an in thing, right? Do you think it was an in thing at that time? Yeah, so definitely no. So in the early 1990s, right, when Windows 3.1 and Visual Studio came out, so definitely test-driven development wasn't an important aspect of programming. So I tried to find a test framework. So a test framework exists for C definitely, but does not exist for C89, this very old version of programming language. And even if, let's say, such a version would exist, it probably wouldn't work for Visual C++ 1.52. So actually, I have to write my own simple test framework to do the testing. Okay, so I duplicated the project, and then these are all the packages. So what this does is that I have an individual test file inside each package, and the test file will run the individual test that will test individual functions. And for network stuff, right, something special, I actually had a mock server written in Go to test the WinSock API. So for the this networking function to send and receive, right? I had a simple program that will just replay whatever that is sent on the TCP connection. For the REST API testing, right? I had a mockup of a Slack, pretend Slack server that will reply the API. So all these are the APIs that I use. Get conversations, lists, history, users, and posting the message. So it fixed the reply back. So to know whether I call the REST API properly. RAM usage. So people ask me what RAM usage. How much does it improve upon the actual Slack app? So let's look at the official Slack app, right? All this add up is about 400 megabytes. Okay. I think it's no surprise to all of you. Slack app is bloated. Okay. What about the Windows 3.1? So assuming I run it in a VM, so look at this memory usage. VirtualBox, which includes DOS, Windows 3.1, and my app is only 132 meg. You include the proxy, it's another 9 megabytes. So the total usage is 141 meg. Then what about disk space usage, right? So disk space usage is, you can see, even with the size of the VM, it's still less than the Slack app. So I don't know what Slack is doing. It's like, Okay, so I'm nearing the end of my talk. So some takeaways that I'd like to talk about. So the first thing is about writing code for resource-constrained systems. People like ask me, right, you do a retrocomputing stuff, right? Yeah, how does it relate to your normal work, right? The link is not immediately obvious. Okay, so in my work, I do IoT stuff. I program for resource-constrained systems where there's not enough RAM usage or CPU where it's very slow, right? System. So it's a good practice. When you write for this kind of very slow systems, right, you're forced to think of creative ways to solve problems. You cannot just, let's use this library, whatever, just use, you don't care about RAM usage. But now I'm forced to optimize things, right? You see how I do the JSON parsing? When has JSON parsing been so difficult? Okay, so learn about things that happen under the hood. So like I do the socket programming. I've not done that in a long time, right? So it was very useful. Okay, reading books, right? So you may wonder what is the advantage of reading books compared to like searching on Google, right? Because when you search on Google, right, you're quite pigeonholing yourself to certain knowledge. But the difference when I come to reading books is that when I read, I found that there's another chapter that interests me, then I read further. I know the front and the back, the story behind all these functions and how they relate together. We sometimes online, right, it doesn't have that feel. Then I understand the pride of yesteryear programmers. Yeah, so I mean there are some colleagues who were really literally yesteryears. They are like probably double my age, right? So they say, hey, those were the days. Last time I know Google, I go and read book, I go to the library or whatever. See, now I understand. Don't tell me I don't understand. Okay, so yeah, so that is all for my talk. I have 1 minute left. Yeah, can you take question, right? Okay, yeah. 1 minute.
Since we have a bit more time, does anyone have any
questions? Guys, you can ask now.
1 minute.
Okay.
What are some other obscure languages or platforms that you've developed for?
My retrocomputing, before this thing, right, interest was mostly in just using. This is the first time I actually developed actually for this. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so this one started as a hackathon. The hackathon app only took less than 1 day, but there's a difference between something that's written for hackathon and written for open source. Okay, so during the hackathon, obviously there was no test. And this app was actually completely rewritten after the hackathon. So I took it over a span of several months or something. Like weekends, that kind of time, free time, I just do. Any more questions? Yeah.
What's next?
Probably a DOS app.
Okay, that's all. Okay, so I'm going to give Kimmy a round of applause.